Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here. I hope you guys are all having a blessed day. I hope you guys are all getting ready for your visitation with your relatives as we prepare for what they call Christmas here. In the whole world knows that the Christ of Christmas, the virgin birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, because of this day they chose, brothers and sisters, hallelujah. The whole world knows about the virgin birth of our Lord and Savior. So praise God. Let's celebrate and remember that our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was the Son of God, born of the seed of a woman. Hallelujah. The seed of the woman, as God told Eve, Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, the first prophecy in the Bible. God says, I will put enmity, or make enemies. You know, there'll be a... you'll be enemies. There'll be, you know, there won't be friends, you know, between your seed, the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent, and you, he will bruise his heel, talking about the Messiah, and he will crush his head. You know, so the head of the serpent will be crushed by the heel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And brothers and sisters, not only did it happened when Jesus died on the cross. It says he made a, it tells us he spoiled principalities, making a show of them openly. He literally also bruised his heel, brothers and sisters. I think I talked about this on a video a long time ago, and maybe many of you have or have not seen that. But when Jesus was on the cross, like if you see the Passion of the Christ, well, what happens, brothers and sisters, when someone is crucified, and people are still crucified today, in some of these countries, they're crucifying Christians. And what they used to do in the time of Christ is the whole point of a crucifixion, brothers and sisters, is a slow and painful death. That's what they're trying to do. That's why the centurion was surprised that Jesus was already dead. He died in only 6 hours. He was put on the cross at 9 o'clock in the morning, and then he gave up the ghost at 3 o'clock in the afternoon before sundown. And so they went around, what they would do is they would put a piece of wood under their feet, like if you've seen The Passion of the Christ or some of these movies, they would put a piece of wood so that the knees of the crucified person would be bent, that their knees would be bent, so that they could push up with their heel against that piece of wood like a block under their feet, so that they could draw a breath, because when your arms are stretched out and then the weight of your body, if they had your legs straight like you might see in some crucifixes or whatever, if your legs were straight and all of the weight of your body were pulling down on your arms, for one thing, the nails would pull through your hands, but, you know, they probably did tie their wrists to take some of the weight. But the point being is that the way your diaphragm works and your lungs, you have to pull up in order to take a breath. When you're stretched like that with all your weight on there, you know, your body's not able to take a breath. Because you take a breath, it pulls you up. And so that's why they put the block of wood under their feet, so that they could, and their knees were bent, like in the movie The Passion of the Christ, is how they did it. And then the person being crucified is able to push with his feet and lift up his weight onto his feet a little bit, you know, to take the weight off of his arms. Therefore, he could take a breath. And then, you know, after he'd take a breath, they would just, like, you know, be weak and tired, and like, because they can't hardly push up because they got a nail through their feet. And then they would kind of collapse and then go as long as they could without taking a breath and push up and take a breath. And so actually, you know, they would be so wore out, you know, that they would die. So what the centurion did, like in the Gospels, it tells us, it says that when it was almost dark, you know, they wanted all the people being crucified to die, because Pontius Pilate, you know, of course, that's why he gave over Jesus. Pontius Pilate, I don't want to get off topic here, but the historical facts are that Pontius Pilate was about to be killed himself by the Caesar. He'd already been warned. They'd already had some, you know, a breach of the peace and some insurrections going on in Israel before. And Pontius Pilate, who was the, what they call the populator, you know, the overseer, or the, like a governor of the place. That was the title he had that I just said a minute ago. He was the governor of the place, and he had already been threatened, you know, by the Caesar. You know, this is all in historical writings. That, look, you would need to maintain order. If you have any more trouble, I'm going to remove you. And then he could have ended up being, you know, killed himself by Caesar for being a failure as a leader. So that's why when the Pharisees said to, you know, the Sanhedrin, the leaders of Israel, said to Pontius Pilate said, oh, you want me to kill your king? You know, he's king. Here's Jesus, the king of the Jews. Do you want me to kill your king? And then they said, you know, totally denying the Lord and totally threatening Pontius Pilate. They said, oh, we only have one king, that's the Caesar. You know, so in other words, you know, they were saying that they were loyal to Caesar. And then they were saying to Pontius Pilate, hey, you better be loyal to Caesar. And, you know, do, you know, we're going to get Caesar against you if you don't go along with what we want. We're going to have an insurrection and all this. The people were getting crazy. So Pontius Pilate, already playing politics, had already turned over Jesus to them. And also, as we know from the story, from the Gospels, you know, on the Passover, they let one person go. So the people chose Barabbas, which is supposed to be son of Abba, son of God. Bar is in Aramaic, Bar Rabbas, son of God. But, of course, he's not the real son of God, son of a different God, son of the devil. He was a murderer and an evil man. And then here is Jesus, who's really the son of God, you know, Emmanuel, God with us. And then they crucified him and they released this fake son of God, another type of the Antichrist. As Jesus said, you know, I come in, you know, in the name of God and you reject me, but there's one coming in his own name and him you will receive. Jesus, of course, referring again to the Antichrist. Barnabas is a type of the Barabbas is a type of the Antichrist right there. Even his name, Bar, like Jesus told Peter, you're, you know, Simon Bar-Jonah. So the Bar is son of like Bar Mitzvah. Bar is the Aramaic for son. In Hebrew, it's Ben, B-E-N. And then in English letters, and in the Aramaic, it's Bar, Barabbas. So that's why, you know, it was really a type and a shadow also of the Antichrist. And then here's a guy who's, whose name means son of God, but of course he's not. He's an evil dude. And he was released. So Pontius Pilate, also trying to appease, you know, playing politics. He was an old wishy-washy politician, kind of like Obama, right? I mean, he was trying to appease and go along, you know, like that guy, the you know, Chamberlain, you know, the Prime Minister of England, who said there'd be peace in our time when he tried to appease Hitler. Here's Pontius Pilate, weak. He even washed his hands. He said, you know, I'm innocent of this man's blood. He was afraid of Jesus. He knew Jesus was somebody. He believed Jesus. He was afraid of Jesus, it says. You know, he was afraid because his wife even had a dream, you know, and she said, you know, I had a dream and don't do any harm to this man, you know. And so he was afraid. But he was more afraid of the immediate danger of Caesar, you know, taking him out of power and killing him, you know. And then, you know, being a riot there. The Sanhedrin was making a riot. And they were stirring up the people. To start, you know, and that's the whole thing all through, like when Paul and those guys, when they went to other cities, you know, the leaders would come out and say, hey, we're going to be guilty of a breach of peace, breaking the peace. That was a big thing with Rome, all across the Roman Empire. If there was a break in the peace and there was a riot and a rebellion and all that, they would send in this, you know, the Roman legions and trample the place like they did to Israel later on in about 68 AD. They leveled the place because of insurrection. So that's how they would respond. They kind of let the people have self-rule, like the Sanhedrin were in rule, and all over the Roman Empire, the local people were in charge as vassals, as they call it, under the Roman Empire. And, you know, and they even interbred, the royalty of all these countries interbred with the Romans and all that. They're all interbred, all interrelated. And then as long as everything's cool and everything's peaceful and the people are paying their taxes and all that, everything's cool. And so they start having some kind of insurrection, the legions would come in and level the place. So anyway, the same thing was true in Jerusalem. And as a matter of fact, Jerusalem never had peace with the Roman Empire. You know, Judah, there was always trouble going on, and they never became a province. They were always, you know, at the verge of a state of rebellion all through their history, which, of course, they shouldn't conform to the world. We know that. But in the case of Jesus, they were wrong, as we know. Anyway, brothers and sisters, let me go back as I cut off on that rabbit trail. I was talking about how that, about Jesus on the cross. And what they did is, my original thing I was talking about, and I was talking about Jesus bruising his heel. So when Jesus, every time the Lord himself, or anyone that was crucified, in this case the Lord, every time he would push up on that piece of wood, they literally bruised their heels. Now in the Old Testament, in Psalm 22, it says that the Lord, you know, it's a prophecy. And all of those psalms, and like Psalm 2, the Lord just had me looking at tonight, all those psalms are written between like 1,000, at least 1,000. One of them was even written by Moses. I think it's Psalm 71 or 72. It was written by Moses. So about 1500 or 1450 BC. And then the rest, lots of them written by King David himself and then other people, the sons of Korah and all this. Basically from about 1000 BC to 950 BC, just approximately. Most of them were written in that time frame. The vast majority, 99% of them. And so they talked about the Lord being crucified by prophecy, you know, King David speaking by the Spirit, gave all these prophetic utterances about the Lord, like Psalm 22. And in the King James, it says, I can tell all of my bones. That's King James. But in modern English, it says he had no broken bones. So the Bible prophesied about 1,000 years, because Jesus actually wasn't crucified about 33 AD. So around 1,000 or a little bit more years before Jesus was crucified, King David, speaking by the Spirit, wrote this psalm and saying, they pierced my hands and feet. There was no crucifixion at the time that King David wrote that, as a matter of fact. And so he gave these prophetic words about they pierced my hands and feet. And I talked about this before. I made a video a few months ago about the dogs of Bashan, the bulls of Bashan, which are the Nephilim. These fallen angels, these bulls of Bashan, are encompassed about me. And the dogs really are those evil people. And the bulls are the fallen angels, are Nephilim, that are surrounding him. One of those two, Nephilim, are half human, half fallen angel. Anyone that is a half fallen angel and a half human and is not a human, they're a beast, they're a freak, they're a Nephilim, they're a giant. Okay, so no one is a half fallen angel and a half man and not some kind of a freak. They're no more a human, but a beast. Anyway, that being said, so when Jesus was on the cross, Pontius Pilate, willing to make, to be buddy buddies with the Jewish leaders, he said, okay, I will appease you and let you take everybody off the cross before sundown, because it was going into the Passover. It was a holiday at sundown. All the Jewish feasts start at sundown. You know why? Because, well, in the Bible, the first day began, it was nighttime. And then so, as we say, we start thinking in the morning or midnight. Actually, we count starting at midnight. And in Israel, of course, they start at sundown, which is just generally speaking 6 p.m. Because the day in the Genesis began with, it was dark. was the evening and the morning of the first day. As the Bible's written, it says, in the evening and the morning of the first day. So evening is first and then daytime. Whereas we in our mind thinking is daytime, then evening. Okay, so, but actually, according to our clock, we start at midnight instead of 6 p.m. Anyway, so they wanted to get the bodies off the cross before 6 p.m. And so they had this earthquake when Jesus gave up the ghost. There was an earthquake. It was 3 p.m. and there was darkness. There was an eclipse. And there was darkness, and then an earthquake, and then Jesus gave the ghost. That's why the centurion said, surely this must be the Son of God, because he saw the earthquake right when Jesus gave up the ghost, and the sun was dark, actually, for a period of, several hours. It was dark for 3 hours when Jesus was on the cross. So, the centurion, the Roman soldier saw this, and the Roman centurion, the boss there, he was the first Gentile convert there when he saw Jesus give up the ghost. Anyway, so they went around and broke the legs, because 1,000 years before, King David had spoken by the Spirit and said that none of the Messiah's bones will be broken. And during crucifixion, they break the bones of their legs so they can't push up on that block anymore. Like I was saying, they push up on that block, their knees are bent, they push up on the block so they can take a breath. Well, if they break their legs, then they can't push up to take a breath. So they would break all their legs. That's what they did that day when there was an earthquake. They hurried up and broke their legs, because they didn't know what was going on, because the Roman soldiers were afraid they're going to run away and all that. Everybody scattered, ran home. There's an earthquake. It's dark. All this, eclipse. And so they hurried up and broke their legs. And then they saw that Jesus had already given up the ghost. So instead of breaking his legs, the Bible prophecy was fulfilled, and they pierced his side. They pierced his side, and water and blood came out, meaning that he died of a broken heart. The Lord's heart was broken. And that's why it was water and blood mixed. That's what the doctors will tell you. If you talk to Christian doctors, that's what they'll tell you, the meaning of that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I wanted to come on here and make this video, talk to you guys a little bit about our Lord, about his crucifixion, and how important these things are to know. Part of the gospel, Jesus was not a man in the sense that we are sons of Adam. Jesus was a son of Adam through Mary, the seed of a woman. He's the only one in the Bible that's known as the seed of a woman. As a matter of fact, if the Lord makes a way for allow you to be involved in spiritual warfare, and you ever get an opportunity to cast out a demon, and God allows you to do that. Now, demons are smart, and they know all this stuff. Now, as an example, let's just talk about this as an example as I'm on this topic. And I guess the theme of my message is about, Jesus is the seed of the woman, and about the virgin birth and crucifixion, all that stuff I'm talking about, how he fulfilled the first prophecy that he bruised his heel literally on the cross when he crushed the head of the serpent. Just like in the movie The Passion of the Christ, when Jesus in the Garden of Good and Evil, he's there at midnight in the Garden of Good and Evil in the Garden of Gethsemane, and Jesus is there, and he's being tempted by Satan, and then he stands up, he's just sweating, like in the Bible says, he's sweating so much it's like he's sweating blood, and he stands up and he stomps that snake, And then Satan, departs from him, and then that's the time he's arrested. You know, it's very symbolic of showing that he crushed the head of the serpent, which he did with his passion. You know, Jesus did that literally by bruising his heel on the cross. You know, and of course it says he became sin for us. I'm trying to see, I'm trying to give this other information, but it's just lining up with me as Jesus said in John chapter 3 when he talked about being born again, and God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever believeth in him would not perish, have everlasting life. He also said in that same famous chapter, John chapter 3, he said, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so shall the Son of Man be lifted up. And if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. He was speaking that he would be crucified. Now, what happened with the serpent in the wilderness, because that atheist who was a God-hater asked me about that. You know, what is Jesus saying? Jesus is Satan? You know, what does he mean? So, I was a new pastor. I went and prayed about it, and then the Lord gave me the answer. I made a video about this a long time ago. Okay, the answer is that the Bible says Jesus became sin for us. Cursed is everyone that hangs on a tree. Jesus took our sin and our sickness and our disease on himself. That's what happened. Back in the Old Testament, the people had been so bad and God punished them. And what he did is he sent these snakes in between them. They were walking through all these snakes. And what God told Moses to do is make like a pole and put on top like a cross. And put a snake on there and walk with that thing. And then when someone gets bit by the snake, okay, that represents a falling. It represents sin. It means representing, you know, being spiritually dead. Okay, but those people didn't know that. They didn't know what God was doing. That's the thing about it. All those prophets in the Old Testament, they wrote stuff. They didn't necessarily know what it meant. They were just writing what God told them. King David didn't know all the ins and outs about the Messiah. He just, you know, wrote what God told him. Spoke what God told him. He didn't understand all the meanings of it. So like right now, if someone gets a word or a word of wisdom or a word of knowledge, they're not required to know all the meaning of that. It's God speaking by his spirit. When we get a word, you know, it's between God and the person that the word is for. What's the meaning of it? Necessarily, we might understand it. We might get an interpretation. We might not. You know, we can, some people get a word and some people give an interpretation. Now, I'm not talking about tongues interpretation. I'm talking about you had a dream. Or you got a word from the Lord. Sometimes it's not evidently clear what it means. That's a whole other thing to get the interpretation. Okay. So, I'm in my classic rabbit trail mode here, brothers and sisters, covering all these different bases. So anyway, so Moses had that serpent on a stick. And, you know, and this brass thing. And then Moses commanded the people, if you get bit by a snake, if you get filled with sin, if you're dying and going to hell, if you're lost, and that's what the snake represents, sin and death from sin. When you get bit, if you don't look at the snake on the stick, you'll die. If you look to the snake on a stick, I'm just laughing because it's like something you would eat, you know, snake on a stick or snake on a plane. So you would look at the snake look at it and focus your attention on it and not look at the snake that bit you and not look at your bite, you'd be healed. You wouldn't die. Okay, and that's why Jesus said, just as Moses lifted up that serpent in the wilderness, so shall the Son of Man be lifted up himself. He will be crucified, just like that snake. And if I be lifted up, I will draw them into me. So the people, when they got bit by the snake, they looked to that snake. What does that snake represent? The snake represents our sin. It represents Adam and Eve were beguiled by the serpent, that they ate of that tree and disobeyed God. The Bible says Jesus became sin for us. He took upon himself our infirmities and carried our diseases. He took our sin. He took it all on the cross. You know, Jesus paid it all. Now all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Hallelujah. Jesus paid it all. Hallelujah. He paid it all. He took our sins and carried our diseases. He took your sin and my sin upon himself on the cross. At the cross where I first saw the light and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight and now I'm happy all the day. Hallelujah. At the cross where you first saw the light. Hallelujah. You looked upon Jesus, as the song says, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Hallelujah. When we look to him, we're healed. When we look to Jesus, he said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men to me. Can you imagine? That's what I'm trying to tell you. That's why Paul said that the things of God is foolishness to those who are perishing. It's foolishness to the world. Can you imagine that you're going to look to the cross, the emblem of shame, as that song, The Old Rugged Cross. It says that, the old rugged cross. You know, it says it's an image and a banner and an image of shame. The cross is shame. You know that no matter what you see in those movies, when people are crucified, they were naked. Can you imagine? Jesus was literally naked. I mean, how much, you know, they beat him beyond. The Bible says he was marred beyond. You know, his vestige was marred beyond recognition. That's the King James words there from Isaiah 52 going into Isaiah 53. You want to read about the suffering Messiah, the suffering servant. Read, it's like the last half of Isaiah 52 and Isaiah 53, written about 750 years before Jesus walked the earth. Here's the story of the Messiah. You know, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was upon him. The withholding of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. Hallelujah. You know, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was wounded for your transgressions and my transgressions. Transgressions is, you know, sins. You know, active going and transgressing or going against and breaking God's law. Hallelujah. You know, we've done all these sins. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's what it's saying. He took that for us. Hallelujah. At the cross where we first saw the light. Hallelujah. And the burden of our heart was rolled away. You know, sometimes we forget what it was like when we were blind before we could see, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Praise God. As I was trying to tell you before about if the Lord ever makes a way for you to be involved in spiritual warfare. You know, because sometimes you say, oh, somebody's faking about being demon possessed. You know, they're just crazy. I've even thought that myself sometimes. People just seen The Exorcist and they're crazy. And then you go to cast a demon out of them and they're just acting like what they saw in the movies. For one thing, I've been in remote areas in the Philippines where they didn't have electricity, they didn't have running water, they didn't have any plumbing. As a matter of fact, they went to the bathroom. I had to do it. Go to the bathroom in the river and take a bath. And you know, I've mentioned this before. I was the only foreigner. There only one person had been there since World War II. A non-Filipino had been there. One guy in 1982 or whatever it was. It was a Baptist missionary that went there in 1982. And then me in the last, you know, no one was alive really from World War II, hardly. Maybe some old people were children in World War II, saw the Americans come there. So I was only the second foreigner they had seen in 60 or 70 years. When I went there, I'd take a bath in the river. And these people acted just like you see in the movies. But another thing, as I'm about to tell you, brothers and sisters, that shows you, very few people know this. Most of you probably don't know this, unless you heard me say it. Another name for Jesus and another title for Jesus is the seed of a woman. All people that walk the earth, except for Adam and Eve, because Adam and Eve were created by God. All people were born on this earth are seeds of a man. A man has the seed. The man is the one who puts the seed in the woman. He plants it just like you plant seed in the ground, and then it produces a baby. It's the same principle. Everything goes on that same principle of producing after its own kind in God's creation. From humans to dogs to apples, whatever. Fruits, vegetables, whatnot. It's all the same. But Jesus, of course, had no earthly father. He's the only one that is known in the Bible from Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. He's known as the seed of the woman. So when you talk to someone who's literally demon-possessed, now there are people who are demonized, who are speaking in their own voice. That's not, you know, there's people who are demon-possessed, but then they're in control. I'm talking about if you ever get a chance, by the grace of God, to deal with someone who's totally demon-possessed, and the demon's in charge. You know, they're speaking with one of these rough voices, and they're, you know, cussing you out and cursing the Lord and all this. I've seen it several times. Unfortunately, but yet fortunately, because it's a miracle to see the power in the name of Jesus and the power in the blood of Jesus, but it's also scary and sad for that person, what they've been through, but usually it's their own fault because they've been involved in witchcraft and all that. So it's a mixed emotion, bittersweet thing, except for when they get delivered. So I would say somewhere between 15 and 25 people I've been involved with their deliverance, at least. I don't know. Let's just say at least 20 people. And several of them, you know, when you start casting out demons, they manifest, they call it. You know, they start manifest. And then, you know, you do all those things. And then what I did just to see if they're legit, even though you can feel it, people discern it. I've worked with people like the house mom of the first orphanage. She has a discernment of spirits where she smells a foul odor. Even before I, she's like, I smell sulfur when we went into somebody's house, because she went with me as a translator when that's how I met her. She was a translator and her husband was one of my students. And because she'd already been to a Bible college in another place. And she would smell sulfur. And then the Lord speak to me and say, oh, that woman right there is demon possessed. So I got a word of knowledge. That woman's demon possessed. But she had already told me I smelled sulfur when I went in the house. You know, and so people have different, you know, different gifts. Hers was discernment of spirits. Mine was a word of knowledge. But to get, you know, together, it was a confirmation of what she had heard, knew. And what I knew, it came together and the Lord instructed me, hey, cast the demon out of this woman. So, you know, it was a word of knowledge from the Lord. And so anyway, what I would do is I would say, hey, these people don't even, can't hardly speak English. They probably don't even know John 3:16. They don't have any electricity, any water, anything else like that. So I would begin to say, you know, the seed of the woman has authority over you. You know, and start using that title, the seed of the woman. And as we were ministering to these people several different times, and every time when you say that, the demons go berserk. They know exactly who you're talking about. Who is that? That's Jesus. He's the only one that's the seed of a woman. So now that you've heard it from me, if the Lord ever makes a way for you and God gives you the unction, you see what I'm talking about when you're dealing with demonized people and demon-possessed people, brothers and sisters. Jesus' name is the name above every other name, all the titles of Jesus. You know, tonight while I was praying, the Lord just reminded me there's a title. I used to know this singer woman. As a matter of fact, she was involved in helping me get ordained. And she's a gospel singer, her and her husband, and Southern gospel singers. And she said that her name was Sandra. She used to love to say, you know, Jesus is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. That's one of the titles of the Lord back there from Isaiah. He's a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. So when you say those things, the Lord knows who you're talking about. The devil knows who you're talking about. A friend that sticks closer than a brother. You can say Emmanuel. You know, he is God with us. You can say, you know, the fairest of 10,000, the lily of the valley, the rose of Sharon, hallelujah. The seed of a woman, of the woman, hallelujah. The balm of Gilead, hallelujah. The Son of the Most High God, the only begotten of the Father, the King of kings and Lord of lords, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, the one who was and is and evermore is, hallelujah. Who was and is and is to come, hallelujah. The Christ, the Messiah, the Mashiach, hallelujah. The Christos is the Greek word for it. And Messiah is the Hebrew, hallelujah. Mashiach, hallelujah. The Christ, the Messiah, the Lord God Almighty. Yeshua HaMashiach, hallelujah. Jesus the Messiah, hallelujah. He is our King of kings and Lord of lords, hallelujah. So this December 25th, even though I don't know, no one knows what day Jesus was born, and it doesn't matter what day. The truth is, he was born one day of a virgin, hallelujah. The only person to be born of a virgin in this world, hallelujah. The only one that's called the seed of the woman, hallelujah. The only one that had to bruise his heel to crush the head of the serpent, to crush the head of the serpent, that old liar, that old dragon, that old deceiver, that old slanderer, that old, accuser of the brethren, Satan, Lucifer, the unholy one, the devil, hallelujah. God himself came to earth and provided himself a sacrifice, hallelujah. As I talked to you guys before, how Abraham, Jesus said, Abraham saw my day and was glad in it. Abraham saw his day when he took Isaac up on the hill, and Isaac said, Dad, where's the sacrifice? Isaac was carrying his own wood. Where's the sacrifice? Abraham said, God himself. God will provide himself a sacrifice. God did provide himself to bruise his own heel at the cross where we first saw the light. Hallelujah. Where he was lifted up, that he drew me and you to him. Hallelujah. As Jesus told his disciples, remember, you didn't choose me. I chose you. Hallelujah. Praise God that Jesus said to me, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. If he hadn't called me, I wouldn't have followed him. He said, follow me, and so I followed him. Praise God. If he hadn't called me, I would still be doing the worldly deal, brothers and sisters. I would still be doing the worldly deal if the Lord had not said, Patrick, follow me. Follow me. Praise God that he called me. I'm unworthy, brothers and sisters. I'm nobody, and I was nobody except for the grace of God. I would be on my way to hell today if it wasn't for the fact that the Lord chose to put himself on that cross, as he said in John chapter 10, no man can take my life. I'm the good shepherd. I have the power to lay it down and the power to take it back up again. Hallelujah. Praise God that Jesus laid down his life and bruised his heel to crush the head of Satan and to make a show. He spoiled principalities, the Bible says, and made a show of them openly, triumphing over them openly. Praise God. At the cross. He bruised his heel. Thank God Almighty that Jesus bruised his heel so I didn't have to have my head crushed. and crushed in the vice of hell, crushed in the vice of Satan's devices, hallelujah, are in the mouth of that roaring lion Satan, who walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Praise God for the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Jesus, I want you to thank the Lord. We have so much to be thankful for. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord and thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank his name. You know, people, you know, the Lord led me to find a song of these children. It's a famous Southern gospel family. And as you guys know, I'm not a huge Southern gospel fan. But the Lord had led me to listen to these family for years because they're very anointed. They're called the Rochester family. I'm going to put a link below this video to a video. I want you to listen to it. These children singing. As a matter of fact, the Lord led me to find this song, and then I found out these people are going to be singing this coming Sunday at a church about 15 minutes from where I'm at, the Rochester family. So I know it was from the Lord. Praise God Almighty. And I want you to listen to this song, brothers and sisters, and listen to the whole song. Listen to these children sing about being blessed and being thankful to the Lord. And remember, especially people in the Western world, there are people watching me from India, people watching me from all over the world. Praise God for that. But most of you, if you're able to get on the internet, of course, it means you know, you've got a little bit of means, especially people in the West, whining about the smallest things, brothers and sisters. And I can appreciate, you know, because I was in the Army for 9.5 years. I've been in remote areas. I've been, you know, slept outside on the ground many times in the Army, had lots of hard times in the Army. Been in the Gulf War, been over there in Iraq, been to Abraham's house where he was born, they say, there in Ur. Got pictures of myself there. Been in Abraham's house. I've been all over Iraq, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait during the Gulf War. You know, and then I was in the Philippines in remote areas. So I can appreciate how blessed we are in the Western world. You guys, most of you guys don't know anything like that. On here debating and carrying on nonsense about the smallest little doctrine. And you're just, you know, you're living in a glass house. You know, you're living in an ivory tower. And I ask you to humble yourself and thank God for how blessed you are. What does it say? As I've taught you guys many times, if you really want to get close to the Lord and get a word yourself from the Lord, instead of asking someone to mediate for you and get a word for you, you can get a word from the Lord yourself. But you have to enter his courts with thanksgiving in your heart. You know, you have to enter his gates with praise. Enter, you know, that's from the psalm. I sing that psalm. This is the day the Lord has made. You know, that song, but it's also a psalm, you know. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is a day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. That's straight out of one of the Psalms. I think it's one Psalm 145. It could be wrong. I can't remember all those ones, brothers and sisters. But that's what we're supposed to do. Be thankful. Be grateful. Hallelujah, that God called you. If he hadn't called you, you'd be lost and dying and on your way to hell. You'd be a stranger. You'd be lost without hope in this world, the Bible says. People that are not saved are lost and without hope in this world unless the Lord gets a hold of them through his Holy Spirit or through people. The Lord contacted me directly. Some people, he sends a preacher to them like me or lots of other people, whomever it may be, to evangelize them, their friend, you as a Christian. God can use you as his voice, as his vessel, as his hands, as his helper to go there and lead people to salvation. That's what we're supposed to be doing. But before you can do any of that, brothers and sisters, you got to be humble, thankful, and grateful that God called you and chose you. Hallelujah, that he saved you. Don't forget where you came from. If it wasn't for the Lord, where would you be? Be thankful and grateful. I'm going to put this link down here. Brothers and sisters, God bless you. I asked my wife, you know, to come on here with my son here, our son Matthew. And I'm going to let them be on here with me and make a, you know, just a little message next time for Christmas. I remember several years ago when I first got on YouTube, I saw Hung, Pastor Dave doing it, you know, brought his family on there. And, you know, brothers and sisters, the Apostle John told us in John 1, 1 John, you know, if you can't, how can you love Jesus who you've not seen, you know, you know, if you can't love your brother whom you've seen, how can you love Jesus who you've not seen? And I've said this a long time ago, and I'll say it again. Anytime I mention anybody's name, somebody has something to say. I know, and I've said it many times, I know that Pastor Dave likes to keep the Sabbath, the Saturday Sabbath, and I don't. I believe that we celebrate the Lord's Day, the first day of the week when Jesus resurrected. And we agree to disagree on that. That has nothing to do with us being brothers. You know, the Lord spoke to me, as a matter of fact, this afternoon about that. And the Lord speaks to me about things that sometimes I forget to mention in the video. Brothers and sisters, these things do not separate the body of Christ. We have one master, even Jesus. And we answer to him. And the Bible says, who are we to judge another man's servant? And it's not just about him. This is not personal. It's about him and his belief, or me and what I believe and all that. It's not even about that. I'm using this as an example, as I mentioned that. Brothers and sisters, if someone is a born-again Christian, you know, there are limits. You know, you're not talking about Jehovah's Witnesses and all this kind of stuff, cults and whatnot. But we are to love our brothers and sisters in Christ. And like I say, I block, I punt, I kick. Whatever term you want to use, I block, punt, and kick people that are swift to spread mischief in the body of Christ among the brethren. As the, you know, people talk about the seven deadly sins, the things that God hates. God hates feet that are quick to spread mischief, you know, and discord among the brethren, the Bible says. And I punt, kick, block, and stop people who do that. They're not doing it on my channel. This channel is my property, just like CNN is the property of CNN. And they don't let anybody get on CNN and talk. They let Anderson Cooper, who is, you know, homosexual and a CIA agent, but they hired him and they let him get on there and espouse the propaganda that they want on there. And they don't let me get on CNN and say what I want to say because they own that channel. That's their property. It's their intellectual property. So on my channel, this is my intellectual property that God gave me, and therefore I control what's said on here. You know, this is not a public forum. This is a channel. It's like everybody has a channel. They own that channel, and it's their forum. They control it. And so if you have a channel, you know, that's so funny. I don't know why I'm talking about this. It's so funny. I say people that are the most critical people, and they go to their channel, and they make videos, and they don't allow comments. Isn't that hilarious? Isn't that? Now, is that not hypocritical? Oh, man. But anyway, brothers and sisters, I intend on, you know, having my wife and son on here for a Merry Christmas video by the grace of God. And as I said, I was inspired by a brother in the Lord, Pastor Dave. And as I said, we don't agree on everything. No two people agree hardly on everything. And that's why Jesus said, if two of you agree as touching anything, it'd be bound on earth and bound in heaven. It sounds easy when people hear it, wow. But in reality, when you think about it and you use, you know, start thinking, you will see that lots of times people can't agree. It's hard to find people to agree on everything. So, you know, I think that's the biggest problem I observe with new people who just got saved last week. And now they think they're the next Billy Graham, and I mentioned another name. Lots of you probably condemn him to hell. But you know, when you get a chance to get off the throne of God and start being a human again, and stop being in judgment over everybody, brotherly love, you know, is very important. Love is really number one with God. Unity among the brethren, that's what God's looking for. It trumps a lot of things. It trumps a lot of things, brothers and sisters. It trumps a lot of things. You know, lots of people major in the minors, you know. And so let's start majoring in the minors. And I praise God that, you know, by God's grace, God has given me association of a lot of you guys who have common sense. You know, just a little bit of common sense thrown in there, mixed in with our life, that we can, you know, pick up on these things, you know. Some things are not, you know, it's not where you don't fight over every little thing. One person had written a comment on one of my videos, really great comment, and talking about how, you know, we can turn non-believers off by fighting amongst ourselves about basically non-important issues. And that's what it is. When you start talking to non-believers and ramming all your little specific little, you know, doctrines down their throat that's nothing to do with necessarily even correct, much less a major doctrine, the doctrines you have might not even be correct. It's only questionable, but you're speaking it as if it's required to be saved, you know. And this is what's stumbling lots of people, and that's why lots of times our relatives, are not open to hearing from us. Not the fact that maybe they also don't like God. We know that. I'm talking about they won't hear it from you or me. Lots of times it's because, the way we're doing it is not in love. It's like a jerk. You know, it's like we all became Doc Kids overnight. And, you know, that's just, you know, it's just not going to work. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless you. You know that I love you. And Merry Christmas. You know, Happy Hanukkah, Happy Kwanzaa, whatever it is that you want to celebrate and do, great. But I remember at this time of year, and remember to use the opportunity to talk to people that Jesus was born of a virgin, you know, and tell, make some connection to the Christmas story, we call it, from Luke there, about the Lord being born in a manger and all that stuff, you know, the story of the birth of Christ and all those things. Anyway, God bless you guys. Merry Christmas.